50 CS each, which, you know, sticks out of my mind for bad reasons. Yeah. Hope we're not going to see that. But it's always been contested. The one actual outlier is when Dade ran the Azir and found Xiaohu on the Fizz, which kind of showed you that. And as we saw at the end of the season, couple of games of Lucian mid, it was like in the Ezreal mid. Xiaohu has those curveballs, and I want to see some new picks coming through, because to be honest, we're what, 7 series is into the weekend? The champion pools have been pretty limited. It's actually been a lot of teams sharing popular meta picks, things coming through from MSI. I want those Chinese curveballs I've heard all about.
Well, we saw a couple in day one. We'll see what we can get done here. Almost more than halfway through day two. RNG on the left for this first game. M3 over on the right for this champ select. Urgot, Azir, RNG's first two bans. M3 will select Nunu as their first and follow it up with good old Cassiopeia.
Cassiopeia and Azir are always the contested mid lane picks at the moment. So it's understandable both of them are banned out. If you see Azir banned, you have to expect a first pick Cassiopeia. So the red side definitely has the pressure to answer whichever of those champions gets banned or looks to be coming through the draft. Waiting to see where they go from here. We've seen lots of different schools of thoughts. We've seen games with multiple mid lane bans. The jungle pool, specifically the likes of Gragas and Nunu, have been hit. Nunu actually making it through picks and bans, I believe, both games in the previous series. It's interesting. It feels like, to be honest, red side's had the advantage because there's not been the god tier first pick. It's been all about strong picks across the first couple of rotations of the draft.
Yeah, I mean, Kalista, they're another power pick, but not necessarily must, you know, first pick, first ban as we move into it. M3 now, one more ban to go through as well. I do like these two mid lane bans freeing up some space in the mid lane, so both Xiaohu and Dade, at least one of them, if not both of them, will have to mix something up. As Sejuani actually going to be the last ban there as well, so popular jungler's banned away. Have to think Gragas is going to be our first pick.
Surprised to see Sejuani priority over the likes of Rek'Sai, but maybe then you're going to price yourself into a Gragas versus Sejuani matchup that we've seen go quite handily, and that is a very confident first pick, taking away a champion that's become a new comfort pick for Dade, and just giving him this situation of, hey, what do you have against this LeBlanc now? Is it going to finally be the Ziggs?
We'll have to see. I mean, few players in the LPL command the respective, you must ban my LeBlanc or I'll first pick it. And Xiaohu is not one that I would have immediately said, hey, sure, his LeBlanc's good, but it's not amazing. We'll see just how it works out. It is a confident first pick, like you've said, and Kondi might just go back to Rek'Sai. Such a strong jungler. I think of the three top junglers that most people pick, Rek'Sai just feels like the most aggressive of them.
Rek'Sai is also the most flexible. It's the situation where we've seen Rek'Sai top, which shows you just how flexible a champion is, but still, ganking pressure from level 2, level 3, so strong with that uncleansable CC and the unburrow, sometimes the flash unburrow. So it gives you those farming options. You can still go Cinderhulk and get very tanky in the late game. I think whatever's available, you take Rek'Sai over most options. Whether you take it over Gragas, I think, depends on what comps you're most confident in playing. Rek'Sai better for initiate because more reliable in the explosive cast, but the reset of the team fight from the explosive cast is just so hard to evaluate, and honestly, RNG will be happy to pick up one of the two.
Yeah, they'll take the Gragas instead, it looks like. They've already locked in the Alistar. M3 went with the Maokai for Looper as well, so very standard stuff so far in the draft. Gragas is locked in as well there for Royal Never Give Up, and M3, two more picks now.
I think it's a very savvy Alistar steal away, because Alistar's been the answering pick to LeBlanc in a lot of cases, because it's another support that can roam and can be very aggressive with their warding and not have to worry about being exploded because of the Unbreakable Will. It was almost certainly going to be a pickup for M3. Basically, every support is dusting off their Alistar and solo queue and practicing those headbutt pulverized mechanics. But taking away onto the side of the LeBlanc means that whatever option you go for, probably going to be squishy unless maybe you commit to the Nautilus.
We actually see Dade pretty animated there on your screen right now, as they don't have too much longer to lock in these picks. Going to change around a couple of things here, but we might just have some surprising stuff here. Morgana locked in, but that's a Vladimir for Dade.
Look, it's not the best matchup in mid. We've seen it in the Oceanic scene go horribly wrong. Dade, I'll trust you, but if you're going to go double escape summoners and opt into a laning matchup against LeBlanc, you're going to have to play super defensively. A bit like yesterday when we saw the Morgana versus Cassiopeia matchup. It's not even the same with Vladimir, of course. He has to get a couple of levels in Tides of Blood before he's able to counter push the wave. RNG with a strong ganking jungler, a strong roaming support like Alistar, and now an assertive mid lane assassin like LeBlanc. RNG have a whole wave, a tornado of mid game pressure, and M3 are really going to have to weather the storm until Maokai can really start to answer the pressure of LeBlanc in teamfights.
Yeah, Sivir picked up there as well. That's one of Wuxia's most played champions from last season. Trundle going to be the last season. Going to be Letmi's top laner there. Still sort of fulfills a lot of the same thing. Very tanky. I actually quite like to pick it. In weird ways, it sort of enables the LeBlanc pick there from Xiaohu.
It's a really weird draft from Anthony to have their 80 carry as the last pick. It's one of those situations where you almost expect a Vayne because they've left it to the last pick and it's been opted into against Sivir to very mixed success, let's say, is the laning matchup. Lucian would be the more reliable matchup in this situation, but I really would have liked to see the Sivir. It would have synergized really well with Maokai and Rek'Sai, two melee range auto attackers that really want to get into the back and CC. It would have been good in lane. It would have synergized with Vladimir in the late game to allow him to really get that consistent damage down. They still stick with the Lucian, but the drafting order is questionable. The result, the only big question mark for M3 is how do you get through this mid lane matchup?
Yeah, I mean, we'll have to see here. Dade seems to be opting into the double escape summoners as well, so going to be feeling that pressure, especially if MLXG wants to come visit for a few early body slams.
And that's the thing. Ghost Flash doesn't help you if you're going to be hit by a chains. It goes through the pool, I believe, because it's one of those tethers.
Tethers really hate Vladimir.
Absolutely. It's always about the Fiddlesticks drain and the tether coming through from LeBlanc. Gragas has a lot of burst damage in the early game. I know you always compare him to Lee Sin in terms of early game damage. The tether and the damage, it's scary times for Vladimir.
It is indeed. As we move through our matchups, MLXG on that Gragas versus Condi's Rek'Sai. Can't imagine we won't be seeing a whole lot of this season.
There's a lot of ganking pressure from both in the mid lane matchup and the featured matchup. Dade counterpicking himself. Look, it's not a true counterpick, but it's pretty close to that for Dade.
He's back. First game back, and of course, that's what he's doing here. Double escape summoners as well, just to make sure. As Alistar, kind of the upcoming support, you have to think. Very popular at MSI as Lev City, of course. Has a Morgana there as well, but Lame on the Alistar. As you said, every support's been dusting it back off, and it's just looked great.
It's just great to see the return of Alistar. It's something different. It's a melee support that can really tank up damage, who can really force fights. The WQ from level 2 onwards, the headbutt pulverize, can change lanes. Alistar Urgot's been perhaps the premier matchup. It's going to be great to see him out here as well.
It is indeed, and with that, let's get straight onto... Nope, not quite yet. We're not getting onto the rift. I apologize.
We're just staying away from the rift. Where are we now if we're not on the rift?
Well, apparently we're about to get back onto the rift, so let's do it. And welcome to Summoner's Rift as Xiaohu diving in onto Dade at level 1. The featured matchup already going off just under 45 seconds in.
Out of context, that looks super exciting, but realistically, it was just an auto attack and a W. Xiaohu taking a lot of damage. Of course, magic resist runes definitely not being opted into by LeBlanc players anymore. And judging by Dade having 32 magic resist, there's you know, being confident, and they're taking Ghost Flash, double mobility, and magic resist per level runes against a LeBlanc. That's basically saying, level 9, I'll be relevant. Before then, I'll steal experience.
I mean, that's sort of Vladimir's story in general in a lane, but I agree with you. Getting to level 9 is usually Vladimir's biggest problem. He's even started Boots Pots as well, which I actually don't mind the start. I guess you can't really go Flask in this matchup.
Oh, yeah, you don't go Flask as Vladimir. You could get an Amp Tome, I guess, if you wanted to be a boss, but...
I mean, Dada is a boss, but I think even he wouldn't bite off quite that much in this matchup.
I mean, you avoid chains with the boots, so it's a fine purchase, but this is going to be absolutely Dada trying to get as much experience as possible and then hoping that in the mid-game, pressure is relieved from him so he can just walk over to a lane, stack up the Tides of Blood, and pick up the CS hole that he's going to be in. He's going to definitely be in a 15 to 20 CS hole at best in the mid lane.
Yep, so we'll have to keep track of Dada's mid lane, as we do see SMLZ and Love City helping out Condi with the Grump. Can actually take the Grump here as well, kind of on his own there as
Doran's
far as the
Blade.
Actually, no, that's a top lane Trundle, so yep. He's just taking some farm.
That's the thing with Doran Blade and just the interaction with the Chomp. You quite happily and quite sustainably take a camp from the Emperor's Tribute. I think I've got that right. Passive, you get that nice burst of health afterwards and goes to lane losing about 150 health, but perfectly happy.
Yeah, doesn't need to teleport. Looper, of course, started the Raptors as well, but will have to use his port. So smart stuff there from Letmi to kick things off. But for the first time in a while here in the LP, although maybe not today, it's actually standard lanes.
Standard lanes, so we can really assess things. When you got Lucian versus Sivir, finally it's not the Vayne to throw the big curveball. The standard lane's probably not too surprising. Always waiting for the level 2 from an Alistar to see if there's going to be any action, although... judging by the heal, it's going to be more the level 3 that's going to be relevant.
See, MLXG is actually waiting in the wings there as well in the mid lane matchup. So we talked about Dade feeling a lot of this early pressure. Quite possible that, yeah, he actually got quite aggressed on there. That Ghost is gone, and Dade with a big chunk of health missing means that Gragas has already come to visit.
The Ghost has a short cooldown. That's definitely the best possible scenario if he blows a summoner spell. Not sure if he actually skilled the pool at level 2. Probably had to, given the pressure that he's going to be undertaking. But just going to be on the defense of this lane, as we expected.
Yeah, I mean, some good smart pressure there from MLXG. Knows that it's practically free just to come in and harass Dade as Love City. Going to do the same hit to Woosh in the bottom side of the map as well. But Lay, usually Lay, but apparently just left off the M here in this particular game. Or maybe he's changing off and cutting off a letter to make it easier for us. Down in the bottom there on the Alistar, expecting quite a bit of farm from the Sivir side of the matchup.
Yeah, it should be farm matchup down bottom. We've seen a lot of people opting into Vayne for the kill pressure on Sivir, but it's more implied kill pressure on paper than it's really eventuated. We've only seen one game where I believe Kid went off on the Vayne in that particular matchup. So just going to be farm wars down bottom. Vladimir would love it to be farm wars in mid, but probably going to be a lot of kill pressure. It's going to see consistent visits from MLXG in the mid.
Curious to see actually the biscuits there as well from Dade. So needs even a bit more regen coming through from his
gets a bit of spell vamp potentially from the utility tree. It depends how many points he's gone in. We can't actually confirm or deny how many points. It's at least 9 to get the biscuits, obviously.
It's Dade. He could go deep. I'm sure he's done it before back in the day on the Vladimir, but keeping competitive in CS so far, which is exactly where he wants to be in. Top lane as well, plenty of farming. In fact, Looper going back early, got himself double Doran's Ring.
Honestly, Zhao has let this lane get away from him a little bit, and what I'm talking about there is that you really want to have the minions push into you so you can position on top of your minion wave and then punish Dade with multiple spell rotations every time he comes near the minions. If the minion wave pushes into Dade, it's in much better spot. So now, given the fact that he's only got 2 minions alive, he wants to try and tank it as much as possible while the minion wave comes in and hold it at this part of the wave so that even with the pull, that tether comes through, Dade, significant kill pressure onto him.
Yeah, just keeping fine actually though is Dade, so we'll have to keep track of that. But a good early start, which is never what you want from a Vladimir lane. In fact, pushing the wave in now as well. Xiaohu does have his 3 points in a distortion, but MLXG might have to come for a revisit, try and get a bit more pressure into that lane.
Well, this matchup will still keep tipping towards LeBlanc till a couple of items come through from Dade, but just the fact that he could actually full-on push the wave into turret is already a small win for him, and he's got the scaling runes. He's approaching the 13 magic resist, I believe around the level 9 when those runes equalize.
It's just a very Dade thing to do, isn't it? Pick yourself into a hole, pick your scaling runes.
So counterpick yourself, don't rune for the lane. Start with the boots and no combat stats, and hey, if it works out, you feel great.
I mean, Dade's always a player that feels very high risk, high reward, so it's that sort of play. Here is MLXG down on the bottom side looking for a gank, but with a Morgana and a Lucian here, it's going to be a pretty tricky one. In fact, Condi sitting there as well, actually found him with the binding there. Good place ward coming through. Lay now trying to peel them off. Love City taking a lot of damage, but does get the first kill onto Gragas. Lay is going to get the counter kill, but should go down here as well. Does flash himself out. SMLZ though will chase in, and Woosh now doing good damage, gets knocked up there by Condi's forced to flash away as well. And as it all stands at the bottom side, it's a one-for-one trade.
But Master 3 played that engage masterfully.
Well done.
That's really horrible. But regardless, the big factor, they actually had a ward to spot Gragas coming out. Got everyone in position, hit the bind, basically instantly burst down the Gragas and won that trade. But they never tipped their hand. They stayed quite aggressive, baited in the Gragas, and got the favorable trade. 2 flashes down, and now they have lane supremacy in bot.
Jeez, oh, Looper as well, really getting into a brawl with Let Me. Ulti's popped across the board there as Trundle uses his to try and all in, actually, but no one's going to go down quite yet. I imagine we'll just see people return and hope to teleport back to their lanes, and Dade also getting chunked up by an ulti as Xiaohu's also hit level 6.
And the lane's gone better than expected for Let Me in the top side. Of course, the thing that we've learned about a Trundle is needs that Tiamat so he can really be relevant, just because he doesn't have any ranged wave pushing compared to a Maokai who has a bevy of options in that regard. Has the long sword, going to slowly build his way towards that Tiamat. But the fact that he's actually equal, now 5 CS behind, but with a wave pushing towards him, fairly equal in CS, is good times for Trundle. Then, of course, in the late game, just throw on that ultimate onto the Maokai and steal those resists that Maokai will always naturally optimize and build into.
Yeah, when we've seen Flandre play this champion, just gets unbelievably tanky as Dade takes another big chunk of damage. Xiaohu navigating nicely there with a Sigil, with his distortion and his ultimate. But Dade, as long as he doesn't die in an all-in, he's usually fine on Vladimir.
It's good that you mentioned the Flandre playstyle, because he often plays this matchup, which makes sense. You build tank, you still tank stats. But when you actually expand on the thought, the big factor that comes, you build the Tiamat into Hydra, Maokai doesn't do any relevant damage to you, and you just take structures. You actually open up a win condition of split pushing, just because you need multiple members in the late game to be able to actually harass Trundle out lane. Has so much sustain between what will eventually likely be the Hydra, and then of course his passive, the Emperor's Tribute, that gives him effectively spell vamp off every creep that dies. All that healing means that he's fairly immovable and does a lot of structure damage, cancelling his autos with cooldown reduction on the chomp. So they're going to have to find a way to deal with the split push. We're talking more around 30 minutes, but it will grow and be a bigger and bigger problem as this game goes on for M3.
And 30 minutes is not that far away, given how quiet the early 10 minutes or so of this game has been. We're just 8.5 minutes now. It's been a killer piece with the first blood going to M3. Dade's starting to get really heavily
chain
pressured,
misses.
Though. But yeah, chain misses is the crucial bit there, and Dade stands his ground, doesn't even use the pull.
Doesn't feel the need to, but of course, once that tether hits, the pull's not going to do too much work. So false bravado might actually be the case here for Dade, but sometimes he makes these self-counter picks work, and so far, can't argue with him too much.
Yeah, got his Hextech Revolver now, actually, so getting a lot of spell vamp back when he uses that Q, which is part of the reason he's confident in the all-ins that Xiaohu continually throwing at him. See, Xiaohu as well got himself a Chalice, so building in towards the Athenes for the matchup, which makes a decent amount of sense. BF Swords down in the bottom side there as well, and apart from that, pretty light on items. In fact, it's an early win for Condi, who's already got his Cinderhulk completed.
Wow, it's a really fast Cinderhulk. No boots or no, and probably just no shopping trip yet for Gragas, who died and has spent less time farming. So makes some semblance of sense. Has a kill involvement as well. And speaking of involvements, four members up top.
Yeah, Condi coming through, but MLXG there as well. Letmi getting quite low there. Looper going to come through. Condi gets the knock-up. Great ulti from MLXG.
Wow.
But Looper flashes after him and gets the kill with the ulti. And MLXG going to try and get in there. Tries to kill Looper. Damage is good. Twisted Advance coming back. Sub Magic does work there for the Maka. And Xiaohu diving in is going to get one kill. Can he make it a second? Landing a chains there onto Condi. Gets him so low, but Condi somehow makes it. No, Looper is going to go down. Xiaohu's going to get the next tether. Condi's going to try and get out of the situation, but Xiaohu out of spells and out of luck. No more kills.
I believe Master 3 spotted out the fact that Xiaohu was coming, then realized they would at least pick up the kill to equalize the trade in bottom lane. Laze actually had to use the ultimate, but doesn't look like any kills will come through.
Yeah, popped his ulti and then immediately comboed him and said, I don't really have anything else with Woosh not in position. So ult's being blown in both the top and the bottom side, and it's 3-for-2 in kills there for M3.
But the big critical factor is that Dade didn't have to leave lane, and only one answering kill came through. So kill score involvement increased. SMLZ doesn't get stunned.
That was a sick black shield there, saving SMLZ. Lay getting way too low, does not have his ultimate. Woosh eats a binding there as well, and SMLZ gonna try and clean up the second kill. Flashes in, Looper's here, but not necessary.
Yeah, Looper not even needed, so now he's not gonna have a lot of wave control. You see the pings onto his turret coming up in top. Very nice play from SMLZ. And as you mentioned, I didn't even notice it. The pinpoint black shield coming through from LoveCD.
Dade now even getting aggressive in a 2v1. Xiaohu gets low there. Dade still has his ultimate. Starting to tank turret hits there as well. MLXG, silly name. Really getting forced off here as Dade's pushing into that turret quite hard as well.
I mean, M3's lanes in general don't give many Mundos this game, Patriot Time. Dade in particular, not even ruining for lane in a tough matchup where there's so many different ways for LeBlanc to kill you. Specifically, just mimic the chains, hit the first one, you know when he's going to come out of the pool, hit the second one. Still significant kill pressure, you don't even get a DPS drop anymore. Letmi's going to take the turret. Can Condi duel them?
Condi's coming in. Looper's actually here as well.
Wow.
The pillar goes down. Letmi, that is some damage there, but Looper going to try and make it count. We'll follow him as long as he can with the ultimate ticking away, but not enough. Good Q there to slow him down, but doesn't get the knockup. Letmi kiting as best he can. Just needs to kill a couple more creeps. Doesn't have it, though, and Looper claims the kill.
It's a game of inches sometime, Pastry Time. Condi was literally on single-figure health, still lives. But during all this, RNG should be able to pick up the dragon.
Ulti though from Condi is going to mean M3 might look to challenge RNG on top of the dragon. It's 40% health now.
Love City. Don't know about it.
Can I get in? No, it's a little too late. Finds the ward, gets the binding onto the dragon, but MLXG smites it away.
They would have had an educated guess, but they couldn't all commit their time to going in. So in this meantime, Condi picks up a Grom, continues the jungle pathing, and RNG finally pick up something for themselves because the kill score, definitely good reading for M3 fans.
Yeah, 6-for-2 now, actually. They're M3, 2,500 gold ahead here in this game. Down a dragon and a turret with the top one going down just earlier. And we can see everyone still powering up. Letmi almost done with his Hydra. Athenes is completed now for Xiaohu, and a BF Sword and an Avarice Blade there for Woosh. Every Sivir is going this early Avarice Blade.
The Avarice Blade is fine. The Yoma's Ghost Blade that we see sometimes, I feel, is too much into the mid game. It's 6 seconds of extreme power, and if you don't abuse it in the mid lane.
Dade looking for a 1v1. Xiaohu flashes in. Sick flash from Dade to dodge the damage. And he's doing it level 10 now on the Vladimir.
And there's definitely some Master Yoda Star Wars analogies to talk about. The old man still keeping a pace in the mid lane, outplaying the young upstart in Jahu. Very nice play from Dada. We didn't see that too often last season. Starting the season off strong.
Yeah, really strong there. Even ahead in CS now, pushing that wave back in. Got good damage on the turret as well. We wondered, where is the Dada that we're used to seeing? How good can he be in an opening game? And at least for the first 13 minutes, looking good. Goes back in a Will of the Ancients is his pickup.
And Will of the Ancients with a Negatron cloak that he'd already prepared previously. Despite the fact that it's a favorable matchup for LeBlanc, it's looking difficult because the item disadvantage, their fiends are mostly defensive option choice. In fact, Morella Nomicon is frequently the choice of LeBlanc's in this matchup just to reduce the healing from Vladimir, but he's going for the more expensive defensive option and now a Negatron as well. Jahu, he's in a bad spot against Dade's Vladimir. I mean, never thought I'd say that.
No, I mean, we talk about it. He does get the tether down and a bit of damage, but Dade at this point just phase tanking as much as he can and not really caring too much. Again, they'll trade back and forth, but Dade, we talk about Vladimir, almost every lane he ends up getting himself ahead eventually, and I think at this point, Dade's just ahead.
And the tipping point was much earlier, and then the scaling runes is meaning a lot, but there's a fight.
Love CD though, pops his ulti. Lei gonna come back in there. Woosh now getting a little too low. Condi's gonna move in as SMLZ tries to get it in. A massive price Seeker gives him the kill to Morgana's Ignite. SMLZ though, far too low, gonna go down here.
Cancel the teleport.
Yeah, teleport canceled in there, so no one gonna rejoin, but that's it, one for one.
Really nice play from Lupa. Didn't even have to flash to cancel the teleport. Had the ward down, so was able to spot another trade in mid.
And Dade just not using the
Look
pool.
Look at the levels, though.
Yeah, I mean, level 11 to 9 now. Dade ranked 2 ultimate, ready to go in about 5 seconds, and he's not even pulling. Jahu's constantly trying to bait him, and Dade is holding his ground every time.
I don't know if bait is the right word anymore, Pecham. He's even chipped away at the turret. This is completely unexpected from Dade. And look, I guess he spent his time off in the offseason practicing.
Yeah, I mean, again, had a strong performance in the promotion tournament. Must have been practicing in the last intervening month or so, because a Vladimir into LeBlanc paying off this well in the first game for M3. This was not the performance we expected from Dada, even though we know he can do it.
And it sounds counterintuitive, but honestly, RNG probably need to actually pull this game out to late and trust on the Trundle to be a solo nuisance. We saw that game last season where Flandre basically single-handedly won the game, split pushing all the things. Maokai will not be able to stop the split push later in the game. The Hydra is just the start of the train that will tip the tip of the iceberg, going to be cooldown reduction, spirit visage, and the likes of the frozen heart. That's when he'll be largely immovable in the top lane. But opting into late game against Vladimir is risky. You really have to be smart at not opting into team fights. And the Sivir just using her ult defensively might be their only way to do that.
I think the good news, I guess, then for RNG is that M3 don't really have an objective that they can force right now. Them having the first dragon means a lot, because you have to think they really want to start fighting with Vladimir being strong, with Maokai going to hit that mid-game point so much earlier. And even SMLZ just picked up his Infinity Edge, and Condi has a Warmogs. Unfortunately for M3, there is nothing massive they can fight for just yet.
And the excitement that we've got about the 8 kills has to also be tempered by the fact that it's one turret and one dragon to zero objectives whatsoever. So they need to start turning these kills and the 3,000 gold lead into objectives, and it seems like prepping for dragon is the first port of call for M3.
Well, it's back in a minute 40 as Condi moving aggressively. That has so much health already, almost 3,000 there in the health pool with the Warmogs. First, they're coming through after that Stalker's Blade, and Cinderhawk does see them moving in. Love City going to try and find a binding, but Woosh will cut the Krugs back and take them for himself.
Very Clear Love-esque approach by Condi. Get ahead on Rek'Sai, build as much health as possible.
And then start diving. That's usually how Clear Love does it, so we'll see if Condi can do a Clear Love impression here. And I think with how aggressively he's moving down towards the bottom side of the map, that's where he wants to look for that first turret dive.
You see in the top lane, Trundle's already very pushed in. He's going to keep pushing. That's pretty much his job. Not really able to disregard turret shots. He'll have enough cooldown reduction to get 4 or 5 chumps off every time he gets onto a turret. So just being a nuisance, clearing out paths. Let Me is the big man here. We would have expected Jahu, especially in a favorable matchup, but it's actually all on the other ex-GUMT player to try and take RNG over the line.
Good control there from SMLZ. Going to give them an outer turret here in bottom lane. That's the first for M3 here
in
this particular series.
Look at the CS. We didn't even mention it.
Yeah, 173 to 125. Basically a 50 CS lead there for the Lucian.
It's a pretty good matchup by Sivir, but this is one of the reasons why I group Alistar with champions like Evelynn, where there's something a little bit different about them. With Alistar's the level 2, and just how tanky he gets at level 6, the fact that he can really promote turret dives. But he's not the best laning champion. It's never really been his strength. Not the best in 2v1s either as a melee champion trying to take turrets. In a fast push meta, he can really be exploited. In lane, if his laner falls behind as far as Woosh has here, honestly, if he doesn't have an all-in option, he doesn't really do anything.
I mean, I think that's why we've seen so many teams swap around, get the 1v1 or 1v0, and just let the Alistar roam, which is something he's very good at. So with the 2v2, I agree with you, Alistar. It's not that he's bad necessarily, it just limits his options, and he has quite a few otherwise.
Look, he's a little bit like a better Bard in that he has some sustain, he does some interesting things, but laning is not his forte, and they're just preying upon bot lane.
Yeah, Kondi moving in, they actually flashed in for an Umbara, but Woosh had their spell shield ready, but doesn't really matter. Gonna get some pressure down, but Looper will force him away in M3. They really want their first dragon though. Let me starting to tank a few too many turret hits here. Looper coming in. That ultimate give gave him so much health back though. Gonna turn and fight Looper. He's gonna keep trying to go in there, but Let Me gonna get himself away with a very nicely placed pillar.
And honestly, if he had turned around, it would have been a close fight, and he got half the turret health. It's just a preview of what will get worse and worse for the Maokai. So important they start to open other win conditions like dragons. Again, bit early to hold them a win condition when it's just 1-1, but MD really needs to start piling on the neutrals. They got their first turret, they've basically completely run over the Sivir Alistar lane in the bottom lane, and now starting to spread that winning mid and winning bot lane into multiple objectives.
Yeah, mid tower goes down there as well. Nice rotation there from the Lucian. So M3 starting to get that gold lead ticking away. You can see 33,000 gold for them. They've got about 5k up on RNG so far. And RNG, like you said, can just move to the late game, try and use that trundle, but the next two dragon fights, I'm going to say, going to be quite difficult for RNG to look to contest.
I mean, SMLZ, 50 CS up. He's going to be donated the blue bus because honestly, no one else needs them at this present point between the no mana mid laner and jungler. Setting up to carry SMLZ, already gone back and bought a crit cloak close to the Phantom Dancer. So even though he's snowballing, he's still opting into a late game focus build, not being tricked into, say, picking up a second item, Yomu's, to really capitalize on how far he is ahead in lane. Because he can happily go the highest DPS build and in the late game be a real force.
Yeah, join Dade there. I mean, Hemoplague, Carlingon, just Hemoplague auto attacks. Pretty deadly stuff there on a 5v5. So good setup here for M3 moving in. Looper actually swapping back down to the bottom side because M3, they realize they want to rotate their AD carry and take that last outer turret.
They want to rotate their AD carry into the lane of Sivir. At this present point, SMLZ is 1v2 and Alistar can do nothing to help. That's the thing. Alistar all in trades like Leona. It's much the same story. Can't do anything in this situation. That's why the first pick or first rotation priority for Alistar sticks out to me, is it's the same as a Leona. If you really prey upon that lane, just has to watch passively as his laner gets denied CS.
That has been collapsed on. Good flash though gets him out from under the Gragas ultimate, but blue buff will be the pick away here for Xiaohu. So no steals forthcoming. Kondi, believe he stole that blue buff. Yes, he did.
He definitely did. Prey Seeker has hit all the things. Sniped a kill down. Bottom steal away a buff to further dishearten the RNG team because they took another turret. Speaking of turrets, though, this is the man they have to take them.
Yeah, Let Me is just going in there. Has the Hydro as well. Can get plenty of health back. Pops his ulti once again. Turns around. Just melts through Looper now as
well. Kill the creeps.
Yeah, goes back to the creeps. Realize he just needs some lifesteal. And look at the health he's getting back already. Looper now going to get run out by the other creeps as well. He's trying to buy time for Dade and Let Me. He's on the wrong side of the map. Going to pop his W. Looper flashes forward but doesn't have the Twisted Advanced range for the follow-up. Rek'Sai might have been joining in as well. As Let Me walks over a couple of tunnels. But Trundle starting to be a menace here for M3.
Hashtag just Trundle things.
That was a just Trundle things moment, that's for sure. And we've seen Flandre do it. Let Me doing a pretty good impression so far.
Absolutely. And it's just the CDR that he's short of. CDR, which so nicely builds out of the Frozen Heart and the Spirit Visage for magic resist and armor appropriately. And he'll be immovable. It'll take more. It'll take Dade and Looper. And if you can't do something that with that on the other side of the map when he's getting objectives and fighting off two members, you deserve to lose if you're RNG.
Yeah, Let Me, again, kind of the person that bridges RNG to the mid-late stages of the game because they have fallen ever so slightly behind, but Goldie's going to keep them back in there. Let Me especially taking out those turrets, going to keep it at still about 5,000 gold between them, and only a Ruby Crystal there for Let Me. I wonder where he's going next. You mentioned Spirit Visage. That's my first instinct, but good choices there with both those tanky CDR items.
It's not going to be a Black Cleaver. I know you're hopeful of one. That would be intense, but you can see from his bias. He's going for Frozen Heart Spirit Visage. That's 30% CDR. He'll find another 10% somewhere and just be a menace.
Yeah, smart stuff here coming through for Letmi. Now quite tanky already with a good mix of mid-game tanky items built up as well. Abyssal Scepter actually for Xiaohu as well, something I wanted to point out earlier because Dade, he's done the same thing and the Dade special, their Sorcerer's Shoes with a nice early distortion enchant.
It's surprising. He had a Null Magic Mantle and I thought, okay, on top of the Athenes, and I thought, okay, maybe Merc Treads, because you look down this lineup, if you get hit by a Morgana Binding, it's big CS values, of course, the Twisted Advance, all going to be coming towards LeBlanc. I wouldn't have minded the Merc Treads. It's a lot of money to spend on just not that many offensive stats, and Abyssal Athenes, that's probably the most defensive LeBlanc build we've seen in a long, long time.
I mean, Dade has a very similar looking build on the other side, but, you know, he's more of a frontliner. I think that makes more sense.
Absolutely. He needs to get in 300-400 range, just pump out those Tides of Blood in a team fight. He's about sustained damage. Burst champions build the big AP value Morella Nomicon into death cap items. Sustained damage champs can afford to go to more utility items like the Rylai's and the Abyssals of the world. So when you're pigeonholing yourself into sustained damage as a LeBlanc with basically at this point no kill pressure on your lane opponent, that's already a big win for Dade, and he had the scaling runes. He has the scaling champion. It's wins upon wins for the old master Dade.
Look at this. This is an EDG level Baron here by M3. 24 minutes.
Chundle's non-boost about
this. There is a ward there, but he does have a teleport. He's actually going to use it right now, but that Baron far too low already. Letmi dives his way in, but Kondi secures it in. Now Love City going to go in onto Woosh. Lay's already way too low. He's going to go down there to SMLZ. Letmi trying to chase Kondi, who's diving the backline as well. Looper getting in amongst it, seeing what he can do. Kondi gets a knock-up onto Woosh. Just chases his down solo almost, but no Praesinger this time, does flashback, gets the heal out as well, and SMOZ gonna keep chasing. It's only one kill on a Baron, but M3 will take it.
I really like the call there from M3. They had Kondi with so much health at this point that he could tank up the Baron for days, re-engages, tanks four members for about 10 seconds, then flashes out. They'll actually add on the inner turret as well, Pastry Time, and this gold is preciously close to 10,000 gold.
It is indeed. It's about 8,500 gold up so far, and M3 gonna go back and spend some big chunks of change from that last exchange. Dragon up in 5 seconds now as well. That'll be the second for either team here, and M3 gonna run straight towards that objective with so many spare items in their pockets.
I think it was just poor awareness from Letmi, to be honest. That teleport came in super late. Baron was at 3,000 health when he started channeling it, and they burst it down from there. Feels like if he had teleported in earlier, I mean, he would have not been able to split push, and that's a significant win condition for RNG. But the result is a free Baron. It's gonna add on, and they're gonna have to watch the Dragon, just like they watched the Baron, be taken by M3.
The Looper gonna pop back to the top side, try and hold off the push from Letmi, but Letmi does not have a teleport if there's another fight that breaks out here, and I don't think he wants to take one. He's actually just gonna go back in to the war here, but Baroned up creep's gonna mean Letmi can't actually split push against Looper right now.
Yeah, they're making Maokai look good in the 1v1 matchup, are the Baron buff creeps. So now, because he was slow on that teleport, it negates his real split push pressure, and basically in every metric, M3 are leagues ahead.
I love this build from SMLZ as well. I mean, you can tell just how far ahead they are with a Bloodthirster being the third item here for Lucian. Usually that's only the item you build when you feel so confident that you're ahead, and Lucian at this point, let me tell you, very ahead of Xiaohu. Gonna get caught there by Kondi. Culling gonna come through and almost rip through the Mimic. MLXG will try and zone them off. Xiaohu's safe for now, but M3 just gonna continue applying pressure.
Absolutely, SMLZ has the rich man AD carry build. SMLZ, Woosh, very much going for the investment banker. Had to opt into static shift, no boots too. And the Bloodthirster is very, very close from SMLZ.
Yep, you can see the Baroned up cannon minion doing work as it almost always does as well. They'll buy their time, they'll farm back up. Dade going to clear out the waves relatively swiftly there as well. And SMLZ, as soon as he gets on top of the turret, it does not take much for it to go down.
They have good turret damage, but still risky to get too close. As you can see, the flash, the cask, not this time.
They're forced to disengage, but Dade going in 1v4 tower dive out under it there. Gets massive damage on the Xiaohu. Hero Plague's almost going to kill him. Pillar will stop them from running back as they pop the Sivir ulti defensively, but binding there from Love CD for the disengage. And M3, no kills, but they get the turret.
Yeah, crucially, the big dive comes after already picking up the objective. Objective focus play wasn't M3's strength over the course of the 11 weeks. They had their ups and downs, as every team did, but it was something for them to practice. But all in all, very impressive first 30 minutes of the league for M3.
And I think objective focus is something that they've actually been quite strongly this game, which has been surprising to me as well. That Baron call was very confident and very
assertive,
well thought
is the word
out.
I
yes,
would use there.
Which is not a word we ever used to describe M3, even in their victories last season.
It was often that Looper and Dade weren't on the same wavelength as their jungler or the bottom side of the map. it was only actually the playoffs, honestly, where we thought, okay, this is against lower level opposition. How much can you really read into the fact that they can play good, smart, objective focused League of Legends in the relegation promotion playoff? But coming into the real leagues against a team like RNG, that again, we don't have a real read on their strength just yet. On paper, still mostly members that made it to playoffs. They're still looking very powerful, and hopefully there's something for M3 to build on.
Oh, Looper follows Xiaohu there with a Twisted Advancements, forced to flash away. Wuxia going to turn on the damage as well. Good headbutt there from Labor. Dade coming back in with Love City, and Condi all going to move in now. Gragas Barrel going to try and disengage somebody, but only peels the tank away, and again, they'll just move back in. Baron buff has dropped away, but they're just going to keep pressuring these turrets.
It is 5v4, but they have to do this, RNG. They need to clear waves and allow Trundle to split push. He's going to back, but remember, they have Sivir for wave clear, though. Whoosh, low mana bar, perhaps just as insurance, and they all need to back because Sivir needs to refill this mana if they have any hope in clearing wave.
Just a little too risky. Looper, though, did go back, so M3 turn off the pressure now. Six turrets, though, as they've gotten the outers and all of the tier twos as well. No dragon up quite yet. Baron going to be a couple minutes away as well, so RNG so far quite far behind here, almost 10,000 gold up for M3. It's about 9k ahead for them so far, but just those inhibitor turrets left to defend, it's going to be a long defense here.
And look, even for how bad the laning phase was for Whoosh, he still got 380 items. He still does very respectable damage. So he's put his gold, the little gold that he's had, to really good use. So he is teamfight relevant. He's certainly not SMLZ. No Last Whisper coming through for SMLZ, but no real armor stacking apart from the Trundle that's going to be hell for him to kill anyway. So it's definitely not a better build than what SMLZ's put together with its riches of gold, but it's competitive from Whoosh, and a 5v5 fight with a pick could actually go decently for RNG.
I think so, but it's Xiaohu that might have the problems right here. You can see Dade already has his Void Staff, so maximum damage, wants to be teamfight ready right now. But Xiaohu, we talked about the Abyssal Athenes, very defensive, just a blasting one there on top of the Silk Shoes already. Not a whole he can do from there. In fact, Looper might have just caught out a jungle here. Love City going to line up a Binding Lands easily after the Twisted Advance. Point blank calling, and Dade comes in for a transfusion and gets the kill.
It tells you something about how strong SMLZ is that he actually opted into using the culling. It was hilarious looking,
was
to
great.
Be honest, but it was enough to pick up the kill. Use the explosive cast, didn't notice the fact that, of course, Looper had Banshee Veil, an easy kill to pick up.
Yeah, Looper very tanky as well. Righteous Glory, Frozen Hut, and the Banshee's all done up. Randy was completed now for Condi as well. It's just riches beyond their wildest dreams almost for M3 at this point. Dragon back in a minute 15. Baron will be back up in 50 seconds. And RNG, right now they have to worry about their base getting pushed in.
In every situation, it's completed items against components. That's what the extra 10,000 gold, which is now basically confirmed, gives Master 3. The Baron and the Dragon both spawn in the last minute. It was 6 or 7 minutes ago when M3 really pushed past RNG with their assertive Baron. And the next Baron will probably be the death knell if it's acquired in the next few minutes for M3.
See the levels as well. Just so much experience being piled onto these M3 members as well. Level 16 there for SMLZ. Condi and Looper. Actually, Looper is there. So is Dade. Condi's almost there as well. It's just advantages upon advantages here. And I don't know if RNG can look to contest either of the upcoming objectives.
It's come to the point where Trundle just can't split push because they have no semblance of control of the map whatsoever. They can't set up defensive wards. They haven't even been able to investigate Baron. A second Baron will negate the chance for Trundle to split push because we already saw what happens when Maokai combines with the Baron buff minions. They're baiting this Baron, knowing that RNG have to compete for it if they have any hope of getting back into the game.
I mean, some decent wards for Royal Never Give Up will give them at least a bit of vision, but Tremorsen's going to land a binding onto MLXG. Good ultimate to disengage and a pillar as well, but Looper dives in on top. Lei, they're going to try and get some knockouts, but takes a lot of damage. Pops his ulti late. Dade dives into the back lines there as well. Ghosting on top of Wu. Does go down there to MLXG, but the Conning going to move through as SMLZ takes that one. It's Let Me Xiaohu going to get low as he flashes forward to Lucian. Lei trying to peel him off there. Condi goes nuts, forward into the back lines. A Whoosh carding as best he can. Mikhail's going to keep the Rek'Sai healthy. Next kill there goes to Looper. He's got himself a double Love City. Flash binding hits onto a creep, but a 3-for-1 win for M3.
It doesn't even matter that Dade dies first. Just how strong SMLZ is. So confident. Black Shield, Bloodthirster, so much sustain to get through fights. He could basically run that fight 4v5, and it was no worries whatsoever for Master 3. Can they kite back and pick up a Baron, though? With Condi starting it, looks like likely.
Yeah, they are going to go for it. Dade might even be just alive in time to pick up the benefits as well. 3 seconds left. Are they going to hold on to it for their teammate? Don't even need to, as it's going to die just in time. And a scrying orb going to give RNG a bit more information, but Baron number two has just been taken.
Honestly, RNG have no good answers. There's a massive minion wave stack in the bottom lane that multiple people have to react to. There's pings onto Dragon, but with the minion wave situation, it's just not realistic. And given how fast the Baron was taken down, it's probably Master 3 going to go down, pick up their third dragon confidently.
Yeah, Xiaohu coming in, trying to get some poke down, but Condi is pretty tanky. SMLZ feels rather safe as
That's
well.
That's not poke, pastry time.
No, I guess without damage items, it's not. Avoid stuff done does give him cost-efficient damage, but it's just not the same LeBlanc we're used to seeing. It's not you from yesterday who I think three-shot a jungler playing that champion.
And the crazy thing is he still has some decent dueling potential, but without the death cap, there's no real AoE pushing. Only Sivir can fill that job. There's quite a lot of tension despite the fact that Baron buffs up.
M3 are just going in for the dragon. Wooch actually steals it there on Sivir as Condi the chain does follow him there. He's going to get aggressed on SMLZ, caught in a bad spot now, but he just goes back in. Looper, Homeguard teleports his way in there as well. I'm going to get on top of the team. Dade and Love City a little bit low there in that exchange, and Condi is dead. RNG got the dragon and got away with it, but M3 still going to keep pressure on.
It is insane that they were able to do that, but it was 5v4. Four members with Baron. You think they'd be fine, but a lot of Baron's advantages around the neutral minions that weren't available in that situation, given that it was a fight around Dragon. With the boosted stats, Looper not being present was a critical factor. So it's only a second answering Dragon. The actual objective they picked up wasn't big, but just delaying some of the inevitable snowball to Master 3 after their second Baron is a big win for RNG.
I mean, RNG just stopping the bleeding at that point with the Dragon. They'll take what they can get, because at this point there's not a whole lot that M3 are giving them, but that's a nice spot there. Does deny that third Dragon, prevents any sort of big snowball towards the fourth, and of course the big powerful fifth, but M3 got a bit more Baron buff left to go, and they're going to pop down the bottom side, it seems like.
Dade go for the split push and just piling on the levels. Level 18, those scaling rules, runes finally reached their crescendo. 107 magic resist being afforded by the Abyssal Scepter, and the 27 coming through from the magic resist per level. Just keep pushing in. There's just not a lot of good answers for RNG. They have to answer a Baron buff. So when the Baron falls down, maybe it's Operation Backdoor Trundle, but for now, they just have to really lie in wait and hope that Master 3 can't find a way to break the base.
Yeah, 4.5 damage items for SMLZ there as well. A Thornmail there for Looper on top of 3,000 health or more. Condi as well, Kindle Gem moving into pretty much any item he wants. Might even go a Luxury Black Cleaver at this stage of the game as well, but has about 3,000-4,000 health himself. M3 again still pushing in with the Baron. Xiaohu trying to poke where he can, but we said not really that much poke in M3. Just going to get straight on top of this turret.
Decent dive options. Dade's been poked.
Good pull there from Dade. Dodges some of the extra damage. Lay, they're going to come in. Great knock up there onto Dade, but they turn it around. Hemoplake down. Looper straight into the back line, just tanking up so much damage, and Hemoplake wrecking faces there. Letmi going to go down. Looper dives back in onto Xiaohu, still not dead on the Maokai. Gets a three-man knockup from the Arcane Smash as well, and Condi diving straight in. Looper did die, but they traded an AD carry.
It's a one-for-one trade, but the Hellfires show that it's much less of an even trade that the score suggests. They pick up the inhibitor as well, can back away confidently. Master 3, not maybe picking up the neutrals they want, given the fact that the dragons are all tied up, but they're breaking the base, and that's what you want to do with a Baron
buff. Yep, needed to break the base, have now done so. It took two Barons to get there, so the game is starting to go on a little bit longer than maybe M3 would like, so RNG have some windows back in here, but still so far behind in every single lane. Trundle really the only one that can get to a late game spot and feels comfortable with his current item build, but even Letmi can't really leave and do the split pushing right now.
Breaking the base is always something we say, yep, that's a win condition. Obviously, it gets you closer to exploding the Nexus, so on a very simple level, you can understand that. But one of the reasons why it's critical here is that we said that when Baron buff goes down, Trundle can go on Operation Trundle Backdoor. That's not an option when you have to actually be answering the super minions in the bottom lane. So now he has to push against super minions. Even with the Ravenous Hydra, he won't be able to do that fast enough. So this whole Trundle anchored to the top of the map split push mission for the 3 or 4 minutes while Baron buff is down and Baron buff hasn't spawned again can't even happen because the inhibitor is down. So it's a big strategic win for Master 3, even more than a normal game, just because of the interaction of the Trundle versus Maokai matchup.
Yeah, you can see M3, you know, continuing to move aggressively, get some vision down, clear up vision as well that RNG has, who again, like you mentioned, are tied back down here in the bottom side of the map with Woosh. Coming out super minions relatively quickly, but going to need to be maybe even a bit quicker. Dade almost has the Zonyas now as well, and he's just hunting right now. It's not on off cooldown right now, but we've seen it already. He will just Ghost and run for your backline.
Distortion Boots, a very short cooldown on the Ghost. Zonya's probably quite necessary given that he's been pooling for damage and then getting exploded on the backside of the pool. It will be available very, very soon, as you mentioned, so that will be the last part towards the teamfight dive comp, the two-man dive of the Korean top laner and mid laner, Dade and Looper. SMLZ, basically God at this point, probably has quite a lot of gold saved up because he's been sitting on the Zeal for quite a while. Is it going to be the static shift? Seems most likely, but Trinity Force has been 5th, 6th item on a lot of these Lucians. Maybe just a bit more burst with that pickup.
I mean, we talked about the rich man's build already with the Phantom Dancer. yeah, it would be the richest of rich builds here as well. So I'm curious to see what he goes. I'd like to see the Trinity Force, because why not at this point, given how far ahead you are. But Dragon's back up in a minute 12. Dade did go back and get his Zonya's Looper, and Negatron Cloak now continuing to get tanky. And we can talk about builds all day long. M3 pretty much just have a couple of formalities to sign in. They'll be on to game number two.
And it's a big pickup, Trinity Force, from the Zeal. We actually saw in the LCK in the Najin versus Anarchy matchup, a Lucian rushing Trinity Force. I don't think it's quite that level. That was back when, I mean, back at the start of Lucian's release, it seemed like Trinity Force Rush was the best way to build him. Trinity Force Rush now not so good, but burst damage in the late game, Bang Shota for SKT, can be very, very powerful. So probably going to fit it in. He's been sitting on gold for at least 100 creeps, so Trinity Force can't be too far away.
No, and the CS value is still pretty high for the members of M3 here. 385 there for SMLZ, 361 now for Dade, as he just cleans up a minion wave there with Tides of Blood. Letmy is the one member of Royal Never Give Up that's really gotten his hand on so many creeps, because let's face it, he's been in side lanes for about 20-25 minutes of this almost 40-minute game, and still back down in the bottom, going to clear them out as best he can. Dragon back in 10 seconds. I don't think Royal can look to contest it here, and again, it's taking a while to finish this game for M3, but almost feels like an inevitability. Not guaranteed, but almost.
Well, it says a lot about the team comp that they're able to pull it out so long, RNG, such as the stalling tactics they've been able to employ, that they forcing, what, triple Baron, fifth Dragon before really they've been confident for the dive. Mask 3, you know, on the balance of things, you probably say need to be a little bit more assertive, maybe need to be looking for those turret dives, because they've been winning fights whenever they face them. They now have the Zonyas, which should be the last piece of the puzzle for the team fight win for Master 3, but they're still playing it a bit passively. The moment this inhibitor respawns in bottom, you know the split push mission will start. And if ever there is a situation where he can split push an inhibitor or a team fight goes the way of RNG, they've got Sivir. We've already seen multiple times that scaling teams have been undone by fast pushing teams just winning a fight and taking multiple structures. With all the ones that have been prepped earlier by the Trundle split push, there is still the threat that RNG are in this game.
I mean, Zhao is working for Arabidons as well. Blade of the Ruin King completed for Woosh. Damage items are starting to come through for these carries, and sure, they're still going to be behind their respective land opponents. Dade now with a Haunting Geist and SMLZ still sitting on top of his Zeal as Lay. Just gets a headbutt there onto Kondi, who's got almost 5,000 health up on this Rexo with a Spear of Azaj, actually, was the pickup with his Kindle Gem. They're going to clear out Vision around Baron and try and force a fight, but it has been quite slow, I have to agree.
Yeah, the crazy thing is that for the last 6 minutes, Woosh actually managed to catch up, and then a casual Trinity Force is completed. SMLZ is item capped at 40 minutes. If he goes to 60, we'll look back on this time and say, look, if you can't find time to dive with a huge Maokai and Kondi on this Rek'Sai, who's had 3,000 health since, what, 15, 20 minutes into the game, then that's a misplay from Masters 3. They need to be assertive. They've been that with the first two Barons, and they're rushing down for a third.
Yeah, very objective-oriented here. It seemed to be this M3. Let me actually gonna teleport his way in. The Baron is gonna get low! Lucian does manage to pick it up at M3. Now gonna start the fight. Dive onto Xiaohu in the backline. Hemoplague's gonna destroy him. Love CD, massive ultimate in there, and M3 only needed one big fight, but they get a full five-man wipe with no death. A triple for the Lucian, and M3 win out in style. That's a quadra, actually, for SMLZ.
Massive quadra for six-item SMLZ. If it went 60 minutes, they would have looked back and shaked their heads, but they managed to take it out. It was clinical work around the Baron. That's three Barons in the space of, what, 14 minutes for Master 3. Very smart play. The teleport was on point this time from Letmy, but not enough. And Master 3 looked very impressive, maybe with some strategic holes, maybe should have been able to finish it 10 minutes earlier, but they went the most conservative way possible, and they didn't look like losing. So credit to them, solid victory.
Yeah, I think safe in the execution of the late game, but very assertive in the mid game to get themselves that lead. So I don't know if it's just confidence fighting in the late game. That last Baron fight looked like genius there, because it's just so many bad choices for RNG when they approach that pit. And you saw what happened, they got completely aced because they're still so far behind. I like the play from M3, very controlled, and Dade, that's the big news for me. Picks again, a losing land matchup, looks for the scaling, looks towards the mid and late game, and lo and behold, Dade might be back.
Yeah, only one game to draw as a sample size, but Dade seems to be back with a very smart play in a difficult matchup. Assertive around objectives, maybe conservative in trying to finish the game, but Master 3, a lot of positives to take away from their first game.
Indeed, and a strong first game there for M3. We'll put them up once we're here in this best of two, but when we return from the break, we'll see if RNG Royal Never Give Up can answer back in